On this great day, that is the birth anniversary of the generous, the pious, the great man that is the son of Imam al-Rida, Imam al-Jawad, peace and blessings be upon them both. Assalamu alaikum, dear viewers, brothers and sisters, wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to tonight's show, where we'll be discussing a little bit about the life of this great Imam that is Imam al-Jawad, peace and blessings be upon him. And I would like to start off by congratulating you and all the lovers of the Ahlul Bayt, and of course, more importantly, the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al-Zaman, on this auspicious occasion. I am joined tonight by our dear Sayyid and a close brother of mine, Sayid Hussein Al-Qazwini, who resides now in Karbala. And inshallah, we will be discussing some key points from the life of Imam al-Jawad, alayhi salam. Assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina.
Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. Allah
hafzak, Sayyidina. So, Sayyidina, can you start off by briefly telling us a bit about the early life of Imam al-Jawad, his birth, the time of his birth, for example, his mother, his father, just some brief information, inshallah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين
اللهم صل على محمد
الإمام محمد ابن علي الجواد our ninth imam may the peace of Allah be upon him also known as Abu Ja'far الثاني his kunya was Abu Ja'far al-Thani. Why Thani? Because Imam al-Baqir is Abu Ja'far.
Abu Ja'far, yes.
So to differentiate him with, you know, with, yes. Abu with Imam al-Baqir, he was called Abu Ja'far al-Thani. And in narrations, especially in fiqh narrations, they usually bring that title. An Abi Ja'far al-Thani.
So that's his most known kunya,
yeah,
I would say,
yeah.
Of course.
You just remind me of a point that in most narrations of especially fiqh narrations, for example, the book of Al-Wasail, when you find a hadith by certain imams, they're not named by their names, but by their kunya. For example, Imam Sadiq is always mentioned as Abu Abdullah. An Abi Abdullah, Sa'altu Aba Abdullah, Qala Abu Abdullah. Imam al-Baqir, Qala Abu Ja'far. Al-Imam al-Kazim, Abu al-Hasan. And three of the Imams had the title Abu al-Hasan. Al-Imam al-Kazim, Al-Imam al-Rida, and Al-Imam al-Hadi.
Of course.
Al-Imam al-Hadi. All three of them were called Abu al-Hasan. And how do we differentiate between them? Abu al-Hasan, period, is Al-Imam al-Kazim. Abu al-Hasan al-Thani is Imam al-Rida. Abu al-Hasan al-Thalith is Al-Imam al-Hadi. Sometimes the numbers are not mentioned in the narrations. We have to see who the narrator is.
So then you can trace back to who it was.
We discover from the narrator, the one narrating, for example, عن زرارة قال أبو عبد الله. Zurara is one of the companions of Imam Sadiq. And so on and so forth. Anyhow, Imam al-Jawad, his kunya is Abu Ja'far al-Thani. He was born in the city of Medina on the 10th of Rajab, the year 195 after Hijrah. According to Sheikh al-Tusi in his Musbah al-Mutahajjid, there's another narration. In fact, there's a more popular narration that says he was born on mid-Ramadan, on the 15th of Ramadan.
The more popular?
That's the more popular narration, but it's not the narration that Sheikh al-Tusi depends on. Sheikh al-Tusi depends on the 10th of Rajab, which we're celebrating now. He was born in the year 195 and died in the year 220. After Hijrah. That makes his age 25 years. He lived 25 years. And maybe some of our viewers don't know that. You know, when you hear of Imam al-Jawad, we tend to have an image of the Imams as an old
pious man, gray beard.
Long beard. Yeah. No one would imagine that Imam al-Jawad is 25.
And you remind me, it's the same with Fatima al-Zahra as well. People don't imagine her to have being killed at such a young age.
Yeah, they imagine her to be an old lady. She was not an old lady. She was either 28 or 18 or 28, ranging
between that range.
In that age period, Imam al-Jawad was 25 years old, very young. Maybe a great deal of our viewers are older than 25. And Imam Al-Jawad at the age of his death was younger than maybe the average age of our dear viewers. Amazing.
And if I want to think about it, so the Imam passed away around my age. So if I think, link it to myself.
So I'm assuming you're 25?
Around my age. Okay. So yeah, so if I want to link it to my life, such responsibility, the leadership of an ummah in the hands of a 25-year-old, an imam.
Amazing.
It's actually amazing.
Amazing.
It's actually amazing.
And we will see that him being an imam wasn't something symbolic. As we talked about in a previous episode on the life of Imam al-Hadi, Imam al-Hadi also became an imam at the age of 8. Imam al-Jawad also, we will see that he became an imam at the age of 8. Imam al-Hadi, his son, also became an imam either at the age of 6 or 8. It wasn't symbolic. Some countries, when a king dies and his only heir is a child, they'll make that child the monarch, the king. But he's not running the show. He has others, advisors and others that are running the show. But it wasn't the same with our imams. I don't want the viewers to think that, he became an imam, but others, his uncles, his cousins, someone else was running the show. No, the imam was an imam. And proof of that is the knowledge of the imam that we shall see quite soon. One of his titles was Ibn al-Rida. He was called Ibn al-Rida. And that was significant because Imam al-Rida wasn't just an imam, but he received political prestige. Al-Ma'mum appointed him as his crown prince.
That's a big role.
It's a big role. Of course, there was a political motives behind that. He wanted to eradicate the imam, but he wanted to gain credibility from people. So he announced the imam to be his crown prince. Anyway, the imam, enjoyed a certain amount of power and prestige. And Imam Rida was a distinct figure. His charisma, his akhlaq, his demeanor, something special. It was something special. So Imam al-Jawad was called Ibn al-Rida. So too was Imam al-Hadi. They were called Ibn al-Rida. He was the son of an imam and the father of an imam. The son of Imam al-Rida and the father of Imam al-Hadi. And in the year 220, after Hijrah, he was poisoned at the hands of al-Mu'tasim al-Abbasi in Baghdad. Imam al-Jawad became an imam in the year 203 after Hijrah, making him an imam at the age of...
The age of 8.
8.
So his imamah didn't last long at all, if he died at the age of 25.
No. It lasted 17 years. 17 years. And historians say that when he became an imam at the age of 8, some Shias were, they were wary. Is this possible? Because he was the first. He was the very first imam to become an imam at that age.
Imam al-Hadi was a bit more accepted because
his father something that had already happened before.
Sure.
But for Imam al-Jawad, it was unprecedented. It was the very first time that someone becomes an imam at the age of 8.
I'll be honest with you, I wouldn't blame the Shia. Like, I speak for myself again. If someone came now and said at the age of 8 they will run everything in my life, they are my wali.
Right. Or a marja, for example. At the age of 8. You would think it's nonsense.
No one
in
this world would accept it.
Right. Because of that, those sentiments, a group of Shia broke off. Al-Nawbakhti and his Al-Firq al-Shia, sects of Shia, or the different schools of thought of Shia, he mentions that a group of Shia broke off. They said, don't expect us to believe that an imam... a child could be an imam at the age of 8. Imam al-Rida was asked during his lifetime, that who's your heir? And Imam al-Rida, his only child was Imam al-Jawad. His only son was Imam al-Jawad.
So
he had daughters.
No way.
So it was clear that Imam al-Jawad is going to be an imam. In fact, some even thought that Imam al-Rida was going to be the last imam, because they said, It's not possible. A child is going to be an imam. So this is it. The imams of Ahlul Bayt stop at number 8.
I'm assuming because of this, there's a sect that's rooted from this, correct? That they believe that Imam Rida was the last imam.
Yeah.
Until today.
In fact, with the death of every imam, starting from Imam al-Sadiq, a group broke off. from the death of Imam Sadiq, Ismailis broke off. They believed in the Imamah of his son Ismail. Fatahis broke off. Fatahis believed in the Imamah of Abdullah al-Aftah, the son of Imam Sadiq, his eldest son, Abu Abdullah, his eldest son. He's named after him. They believed in his Imamah because they assumed that the eldest is the Imam. Has to be the eldest.
But that's not necessarily true, because we see even about Abdullah al-Hussein that there's narrations that say, I believe, that Ali al-Akbar was older than Imam al-Sajjad.
Yes, he was he was older. It's not always the case. Al-Imam al-Hassan al-Askari, his older brother, Sayyid Muhammad, Sab' al-Dijail, in Balad, who, you know, many followers of Ahl Bayt, they go and visit him when they go to Samarra. Sayyid Muhammad was older than Al-Imam al-Hassan al-Askari. I apologize. He was the brother of Al-Imam, the brother of Imam Al-Hadi.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah, yes.
Was he the brother? He was either the brother of Imam Al-Hadi or the son of Imam Al-Hadi. Anyhow, he was not the, he was the oldest.
He was the oldest, but the younger brother became Imam.
Ahsant.
Sure.
He was the oldest, but the younger brother became, he was the son of Imam Al-Hadi.
Sure.
Sayyid Muhammad ibn al-Imam Al-Hadi. He was older than Imam Al-Hassan Al-Askari. Yet he died and his brother became an imam. Imam Rida was asked that your heir is Jawad, Muhammad ibn Ali al-Jawad. How is this possible? Imam Rida answered them. He said, Yahya, Prophet Yahya alayhi salam. The Quran says regarding Prophet Yahya, وَآتَيْنَاهُ الْحُكْمَ صَبِيَّ. We gave him hukm. Hukm means wisdom.
Wisdom.
Not power. Because Yahya never became a ruler or a king. We gave him wisdom, we gave him knowledge, meaning we gave him prophethood at a young age. This is one. And Prophet Isa alayhi salam.
Well, that's
he was still in his cradle. He was an infant. He started speaking. Qala inni Abdullah. And he's still, you know, an infant. Historically speaking, after the death of Imam Rida, some Shias, they, you know, they didn't know what to do. They went to Abdullah ibn Musa ibn Ja'far.
Okay.
Meaning the brother,
the brother of
Imam Rida.
Bali.
Imam Rida had a brother by the name of Musa. I'm sorry, by the name of Abdullah. They said, well, you're the eldest from this family. You have to be the Imam. And he did not say no. He did not say no. You know, one of the signs of an imam, to prove that you're an imam, you have to answer questions. You're given questions.
Of course.
And you have to know the answer. So, but if you start...
So they must have put this through a test.
Ahsant.
To the people.
Yeah, there's a test. But if you start stuttering, you don't know how to answer, then obviously you're not an imam. And sometimes the answers is clear cut. For example, they'll hold a bag full of dinars and they'll close it and they will ask
how much
is in the bag. And this question was posed to Imam al-Hadi, Imam al-Mahdi, ajallahu ta'ala farajah, after the death of his father Imam al-Hassan al-Askari, and he was able to answer how many dinars. They asked questions like this. Abdullah was not able to answer. They came to Imam al-Jawad and he was able to answer. So it was a major test for the Shia after the death of Imam Rida. Who's our Imam? Some broke off, some became waqifa. Waqifa were those that stopped at Imam Al-Kadhim and did not even accept Imam Rida. They went back to waqifa. But according to many historians, the majority accepted Imam
Jawad. So generally, we could say it was accepted by the Shia, but there were those sects that broke
off. There were those that broke off.
Same as they did with Imam, like Imam al-Sadiq and other Imams.
Absolutely. Historians mention that 80 scholars came from Baghdad, from the Shia. Shia living in Baghdad, in Iraq at the time. They came to Medina to find out who's the Imam. And of course, in addition, you know, to the lack of technology and means of communication, Shias were not able to spread the word of who the Imam was. The Imams, they purposely tried to hide who the next Imam is going to be, because that Imam is going to be in danger. To the Abbasid dynasty, he's going to be, you know, under watch.
They were all killed.
They were all killed and poisoned.
Of course.
So they had their eyes set on the next imam.
Take precaution, of course.
So they tried to hide. They tried to hide who the next imam is. Imam al-Sadiq, interestingly, Imam al-Sadiq was asked, who is going to be the imam after you? Every time he gave a different reason. Every time he gave a different name. He gave five different names. And one of the names was Al-Mansur al-Dawaniqi, the Khalifa of the time.
He wanted to kill each of the names.
If you want to kill them, well, guess what? The Khalifa is my successor. So that was a political way to hide the name of the Khalifa after him. 80 scholars came from Baghdad, and they came to the house of Imam al-Sadiq. The house of Imam al-Sadiq was the face of the Ahlul Bayt. You wanted to see the Ahlul Bayt, you go to the house of Imam al-Sadiq, and Abdullah ibn Musa ibn Ja'far, he greeted them, and he came and he sat at the center of the majlis. Meaning what? That I'm the Imam. They began asking him questions in which he was not able to answer. They realized that he's not the Imam. After him, Imam al-Jawad, 8 years old, he came out in front of these men. He came and sat at the center of the majlis. He was asked some of the most difficult questions, but he was able to answer with proof and evidence. They left declaring that Muhammad ibn Ali al-Jawad is the Imam of our time. Imam al-Jawad witnessed two khulafa. Imam al-Hadi, his son, witnessed five of the khulafa. Imam al-Jawad only witnessed two. He witnessed al-Ma'mun al-Abbasi, who killed his father, al-Imam Rida. Sure. And he lived through the time of al-Ma'mun for 23 years, which is most of his life. And at the death of al-Ma'mun, al-Mu'tasim al-Abbasi became the Khalifa for only 2 years. In the second year of al-Mu'tasim's reign, he killed al-Imam al-Jawad. In the year 215, which means that Imam al-Jawad was 20 years of age.
So 5 years before his martyrdom.
5 years before his martyrdom, he got married, and his wife was al-Ma'mun's daughter, Umm al-Fadl.
That raises some questions.
Some questions as to why would Imam al-Jawad marry al-Ma'mun's daughter. Not only is al-Ma'mun a khalifa, he's ruthless, he's a tyrant, he's a dictator. He's an enemy of the Ahlul Bayt. He killed his own father. Why would you marry his daughter? Historians say that he was under pressure by al-Ma'mun himself. It was at the request of al-Ma'mun for Imam al-Jawad to marry his daughter.
This is a very important point you're making now. There's many questions that will be raised about why he would marry the Khalifa's daughter.
Sure.
Inshallah, we can come back to this question after a short break.
Sure.
So join us in a few moments, inshallah. We will continue on the life, key points in the life of Imam al-Jawad, inshallah, and mainly and more specifically, why did he marry the daughter of al-Ma'mun? So join us after the break, inshallah.
جواد الأئمة يا سيدي أتينا لبابك كي نهتدي جواد الأئمة يا سيدي أتينا لبابك كي نهتدي علمنا يقينا بأن الذي يريد الإله بكم يبتدي تحوم الملائك طرا عليه وفودا من الباب للمرقد علمنا يقينا بأن الذي يريد الإله بكم يبتدي تحوم الملائك طرا عليه وفودا من الباب للمرقد وتمسح منك الضريح الشموس فيرقى جمالا على الفرقد وتمسح منك الضريح الشموس فيرقى جمالا على الفرقد وتمسح منك الضريح الشموس فيرقى جمالا على
السلام عليكم. Welcome back, dear viewers, to the show where we are celebrating the birth of Imam al-Jawad. Again, I am joined by my dear brother and friend Sayid Hussein Al-Qazwini, where he is touching on some key points on the life of Imam Al-Jawad. Now, before the break, we spoke a bit about the early years of Imam Al-Jawad and how he became Imam at the age of 8. And towards the end, we spoke about something which really raises questions about the Imam marrying the daughter of the Khalifa of the time, who was a clear enemy of the Ahlul Bayt. Sayyidina, can you just elaborate on that, please? And how did that happen? Like, what was the benefits of such a marriage? Why did he marry the Imam's daughter?
There's various narrations. I found various narrations on where, when, and why Imam Al-Jawad married Al-Fadl, the daughter of Al-Ma'mun. One narration says that he married her during the life of Imam Al-Rida, his father, in Khurasan.
But wouldn't that make him...
That wouldn't make sense because he's only eight years old. Unless it was a...
Arranged.
Ceremonial marriage.
Sure.
It was just a ceremonial marriage. That is one reason. That's one narration. Another narration says that, he married her in Baghdad. After the death of his father, after a while, Imam Rida died when Imam Jawad was at the age of 8. According to this narration, he married her at the age of 20. So about 12 or 13 years after the death of his father.
But then that wouldn't make sense either because, I don't know, I'm just speculating here. Imam al-Hadi became Imam at the age of 8 also,
right.
Correct?
Right.
So if you calculate, if he married her, how many years after on that narration?
No. See, Imam al-Hadi was not her daughter. Not her son, I apologize. Imam al-Hadi was the son of another wife.
Previously.
Of Imam al-Jawad,
sure,
yes.
Sure.
And not al-Fadl.
Okay, so if someone was to ask, how can the line of the Imamah come from the Abbasid?
Right.
It's not.
Right, no, yeah, it's sure. not. And Imam al-Jawad had another wife by the name of Sumana al-Maghribiya. And his children from her, they were not from al-Fadl.
Just sorry on that point, I think all the Imams, post Imam al-Sadiq, married North African wives, right?
Right.
So all the Imams after Imam al-Sadiq, all their mothers were North African, correct?
Right, great deal of them. Mm. Of course, many of them were female slaves because there were conquests in North Africa
and
they were bringing female slaves. Anyhow, so why did Imam al-Jawad marry al-Fadl, the daughter of al-Ma'mun? Well, one reason could be that al-Ma'mun needed credibility. These Khulafa, they needed credibility. They came to power with the slogan, with the excuse that we are the Ahlul Bayt.
Yeah, true Islam.
We're the true Islam. We're the true family of Rasulullah.
And they are related.
They are related. Yeah. They're the cousins of Rasulullah and the Ahlul Bayt. But once they came to power, they persecuted the actual Ahlul Bayt, the grandchildren of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So one, he needed credibility. Two, there was political tension at the time. There was a lot of political tension. Al-Ma'mun had a battle with his brother Al-Amin. Al-Amin was in Baghdad. Al-Ma'mun was in Khurasan.
Sure.
They were both the children of Harun al-Rashid. And there were major conflicts. So he wanted to use whatever he could get. Any praise, any poem, any person that would stand with him, that gave him credit.
No matter who they were,
That gave him credibility. Mm. So that's why he drew Imam Rida to him. He took him from Medina to Khurasan and appointed him as the crown prince because he wanted credibility. And two, he gave his daughter to Imam al-Jawad. Another reason, maybe even a bigger reason, is that al-Ma'mun poisoned Imam Rida, right? And all fingers were pointing to him. Of course, he did not admit.
So to cover the...
To cover for that crime, and to say that, well, I didn't kill Imam Rida, and proof of that is that his son is marrying my daughter. If I had killed his father, why would he marry my daughter? Correct? So there's no doubt about it that it was a political scheme. And however way you look at it, he gave his daughter, it was a smart move. Would he have found someone better than Imam Al-Jawad to give his daughter to? If it's beauty, Ahlul Bayt have beauty. If it's knowledge, if it's piety, if it's righteousness, whatever
they
you want.
They are everything.
They have everything. Mm. So he had no reason not to give his daughter, but most likely it was politically motivated. So marriage is always politically motivated.
So that's from the aspect of Al-Ma'mun. Right. But what pushed Imam Jawad to accept such a marriage? Mm.
Most likely it was taqiyya. Mm. Taqiyya. You know, what got Imam Al-Rida to move to Khurasan? What got Imam Al-Kadhim to move to Baghdad? What got Imam Al-Jawad to move to Baghdad? What got Imam Al-Hadi and Imam Al-Hasan Al-Askari to move to Samarra? Taqiyya. It was out of fear. They didn't have a choice. It was either that or face death.
And it's not that... The line of the Imamah is gone.
It's not that the Ahlul Bayt feared death or... No, but it will eradicate the school of thought. Mm. It would put Islam into danger. So he had no other choice.
You see that in the lives of a lot of the imams, the majority of them, in fact, even like you could say the Prophet, like there's a lot of the marriages that were very political.
Political, absolutely. Mm. You know, this reminds me of a story in almost contemporary times, or, you know, maybe in the past 150, 200 years ago, a scholar by the name of Al-Mirza Al-Qummi. Mm. Al-Mirza Al-Qummi, the author of Al-Qawaneen, Qawaneen Al-Usul, was a well-known scholar in Iran, in Qum, and he's buried in Qum. He's buried next to the shrine of Sayyidah Ma'asuma. He was a well-known scholar.
Sure.
At the time, the Shah of his time, possibly Nasr al-Din Shah, possibly. Anyway, someone who's, you know, a dictator, someone who is despised by the people, not popular.
Sure.
His government was...
Unjust.
Not just unjust, but it was under pressure. At any moment, there could have been a revolution against him. So he thought of a move. He came to Qum, and he asked Mirza Qummi. He saw that he has a young son, beautiful, handsome young man. He told him, I want your son to marry my daughter. Of course, it was a political move. What brought a king to the doorstep of a scholar? Scholars live a humble life, simple life. Mm. Kings live like kings. Why would he want the son of a scholar to marry his daughter?
And why would the scholar want to marry his son of
a king? And why would a scholar want his son to marry the daughter of a king? It was purely a political move. It would buy him credibility. He would say, see, if I'm a bad person, why would Mirza Al-Qummi's son marry my daughter? Historians say that night. This is mentioned in history books. Sure. There's a book called Qusas Al-Ulama, Story of Scholars by Al-Tinkabuni. Hmm. Very well-known book and well-known scholar. Well-known author. He says that night Al-Mirza Al-Qummi stood for Salat al-Layl and he raised his hand to Allah to take away the life of his son. To take away the life of his son. He said, because if my son marries the daughter of the king, I'm going to give him credibility. If I say
it's
no...
Like aiding and abetting. Yeah.
If I say no, I'm going to put my life in danger and the life of my son and the life of many people in danger. He asked Allah to take away his son. When he woke up early in the morning, he heard shouting and crying in the house. People came and they saw that his son was dead. Allah answered his dua. Amazing. Amazing. So the marriage of Imam Al-Jawad to Umm Al-Fadl, the daughter of Al-Ma'mun, was definitely politicized. Definitely. Imam Al-Jawad didn't benefit anything. He had nothing to gain. In fact, he had a lot to lose.
Of course.
People would have been might have told him, you know, what are you doing marrying the daughter of the Khalifa? Mm. The murderer of your father.
He must have lost many followers, I'm guessing.
Perhaps, or maybe credibility, or... But at the end of the day, it was taqiyya. He had no other choice.
I'm sure it was the best of many options.
Absolutely.
Of course, the Imam obviously would have made the best decision because everything he does is from Allah.
Of course.
So, I'm guessing that was, the only option, not just the best of many options.
Of course.
But we clarified that the line of the Imamah did not come from this wife.
No. It was from Sumana al-Maghribiyya, from another wife.
From another wife. So, we've spoken about... Actually, quick question that actually just popped up to my mind. Did you have any children from this wife?
No. Al-Fadl?
Al-Fadl.
No children.
No children.
Historians say he didn't have any children from her.
Are there some narrations that would say that he had?
Or? No. They all agree that he didn't have any children.
So, that's clear cut. No one can come and say, you know, he had the child and that's possibly the lineage of the Imam and then...
No, it wasn't. He didn't have any children from Umm al-Fadl. And they call her Umm al-Fadl as a nickname.
As a nickname.
As a title. Imam Al-Jawad, his father, Imam Rida, would call him Abu Ja'far. And he was only 8 years old. These were nicknames. It doesn't necessarily mean that he has a child in that name.
It was just a kunya.
It was just a kunya.
Then Sayyidina, I've heard this story before, more of a narration, that Imam Al-Jawad had a debate, I believe, with a famous scholar called Yahya ibn Akhtham. What is this debate about? Because this is a well-known debate. It is a big keystone in history. You know, a lot happened because of this debate. Ahsan. Can you touch upon this?
Sure. In fact, this debate is related to the marriage of Imam Al-Jawad. Uh-huh. When Al-Ma'mun gave his daughter to Imam Al-Jawad, son of Bani Abbas, yani his cousins, his, the royal family, so to speak, they told him, what are you doing? Why are you giving your daughter to Imam Al-Jawad?
To those who took Khilafah from us.
Ahsan. Well, actually, they didn't take the Khilafah, but those who want to take the Khilafah.
Want to take the Khilafah, yeah.
Our adversaries, our enemies. Why are you giving your daughter to him? So he wanted to prove to them that this man is qualified. I didn't give my daughter to, you know, a regular person, but to someone who is qualified. So he gathered them at his mansion, and he brought Imam Al-Jawad at a, you know, very young age. And he brought Yahya ibn Akhtham. I believe that part of the story is true. The debate did occur, but it didn't occur because of the marriage. Because I believe Imam Al-Jawad was much younger. He was 8 or 9 years old when this story took place.
So before the marriage?
Before the marriage. So I think there's...
Unless we take the narration where he got married...
Ahsan. Okay. That he married at the age of eight. Mm. Or maybe even before that.
So it's possible if we take that narration.
It is possible.
If we take the narration that he married many years after, like I believe 12, 13 years after,
right,
then it wouldn't make sense for it to be about the marriage.
Right, right. I think it requires a lot more study. Sure. We have to carefully study these narrations to see, does this, you know, add up or doesn't add up?
Yeah.
Anyway, the story goes as follows, that Al-Ma'mun gathered Yahya ibn Akhtham and Imam Al-Jawad and Bani Al-Abbas, you know, I imagine that it's a court full of people, and everyone's gathered to see what's going to happen. Yahya ibn Akhtham was the scholar of, you know, Al-Ma'mun Al-Abbasi. He's the official...
So he's the official,
yeah, you could
religious
say
authority.
He's the Grand Mufti, so to speak. And Yahya ibn Akhtham, you know, I've seen Sayyid Al-Khoi. Sayyid Al-Khoi in Mu'jam Rijal Hadith, in his book on biographies, when he mentions Yahya ibn Akhtham, he says, "Kana khabithan." He was evil, really evil.
So no hadith that came from him is
acceptable. No. Yahya ibn Akhtham purposely tried to humiliate the imams. Not just once or twice, but he purposely tried to humiliate. Al-Ma'mun had told Yahya ibn Akhtham, ask your hardest questions. And here I think that this narration is not authentic. The one that says Al-Ma'mun was trying to prove the knowledge of Imam Al-Jawad to Bani Al-Abbas. No, on the contrary, he was trying to
disprove.
Sure. He was trying to disrespect Imam Al-Jawad. Mm. To show the people that, look, you Shia, you think that this 8-year-old child is an imam, I'll prove to you that he's
not. That would make sense why it would be before the marriage. Ahsan. Because if it was after the marriage, he'd want to prove the worthiness of Imam Al-Jawad.
Yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyhow, so Yahya ibn Akhtham poses one question. He only posed one question. He told him that if a muhrim, muhrim is a person who goes to hajj and is in the state of ihram. إذا المحرم قتل صيدا ماذا يفعل؟ وماذا ما على المحرم إذا قتل صيدا. If a muhrim, a person who's in the state of ihram, kills an animal, what should he do? What is the kafara? What is the
punishment?
Financial punishment or financial fine he has to pay. And he thought that this was a very difficult question posed to Imam Al-Jawad. The narration says that Imam Al-Jawad started posing many possibilities. He told him, well, what do you mean? Do you mean this, or this, or this, or this, or that? And if you mean this...
Was it a wild animal or not a wild animal? Was it in Mecca?
Which animal did you mean? Mm. Is it a wild animal or not a wild animal? Two, is it a bird, is a flying animal or not a flying animal? Three so is an animal that lays eggs.
So he showed a flaw even in the question itself.
That he knows that the laws of the various, dissection, dichotomy of this. Was it in Mecca or was it outside of Mecca?
So
is
not,
it in
the not Haram? Not only did he answer the question, but he broke it down and
he
answered
down
all
to
the questions.
To so many categories that Yahya ibn Akhtam and Al-Ma'mun were mind-boggled. They were, as you say in the UK, they were baffled.
They were baffled.
By the answers of an 8-year-old or 9-year-old Al-Imam Al-Jawad giving, so many answers. How is this possible? And as we say in Arabic, انقلَبَ السِّحْرُ عَلَى السَّاحِرِ,
The sorcery flipped over onto the sorcerer.
The magic of the sorcerer flipped onto him, and it worked onto him and not on
others. He dug his own grave.
He dug his own hole and trap.
So truly, back to this British terminology, it truly baffles me.
Absolutely.
An 8-year-old up against the Grand Mufti, or so-called Grand Mufti of the time, put him to shame and proved his imam. I think this is one of the points where he proved his imam as well, through this debate.
Right, absolutely. There was another debate by Imam Al-Jawad and Yahya ibn Akhtham. Do we have enough time?
Yes, we do.
On the show. Another debate with Yahya ibn Akhtham. The narration doesn't say if it was in the same gathering or in another gathering. I'm assuming it was another gathering. Why? Because Imam Al-Jawad went to Baghdad twice. Once as a visit, and the second time he stayed. He was forced to stay, and he was killed. He was poisoned at that time. So I'm assuming that Imam Al-Ma'mun, he got Imam Al-Jawad to come to his mansion several times. So in another debate, Yahya ibn Akhtham wanted to put Imam Al-Jawad on the spot. He told him, what do you think of the hadith al-Qudsi, by Allah, in which Allah asked the Prophet, he told him that I am pleased with Abu Bakr. But is...
Hadith al-Qudsi.
Yeah, supposedly.
Supposedly, okay.
Supposedly. Yahya ibn Akhtham is asking Imam Jawad. He says, what do you think of the Hadith al-Qudsi in which Allah asked the Prophet, he told him, I am pleased with Abu Bakr, but ask him, is he pleased with me?
Okay.
Allah wants to know if Abu Bakr is pleased with him. Imam al-Jawad, obviously he has to perform taqiyah. He's being put on the spot because Ahlul Bayt are known to have taken a stand against the Khulafa, those who took the Khulafa away from Ali ibn Abi Talib. So Imam al-Jawad had to give an intelligent answer, a smart answer. He said, I don't deny the virtues of Abu Bakr. I don't want to deny the virtues of Abu Bakr. However, this hadith is fabricated. Why? Because why would Allah want to know if Abu Bakr is pleased with him? If Abu Bakr is pleased, Allah would know. If he's not pleased, he would also know. Why would he ask the Prophet to ask Abu Bakr, is he pleased with Allah? Especially when the Quran says...
Could you say that's a form of not kufr, but just to state that, that's saying that Allah is not all-knowing.
Ahsan? Yeah. That means if this hadith is true, that means Allah is ignorant. Nastajiru billah. Nastajiru billah. Especially when the Quran says, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ وَلَعْنَمُ مَا تُوَسْبِسُ بِهِ نَفْسُهُ وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ. We have created man, and we know what's happening in his mind. We know what he thinks and what he feels. And we are closer to him than his jugular vein. If Abu Bakr is pleased or not pleased,
whether he is, that's irrelevant. Because
that's
Allah
irrelevant.
Would
Allah would know. So why would he ask? So he says...
Either way, I think we all know the answer to
we
that.
All know the
we
answer.
All know the answer to that.
So Imam al-Jawad says, with all due respect, basically, with all due respect to Abu Bakr, I don't want to deny his virtues. Of course, this isn't a state of taqiyya, but this hadith is fabricated.
With all due respect, but is there any respect due? That's the
and then he goes on, and he says, what do you think of the hadith that says Abu Bakr and Umar on earth are like Jibra'il and Mika'il in the sky, likening Abu Bakr and Umar to Jibra'il and Mika'il. What do you think of this hadith? Imam al-Jawad, again, he says that this hadith has been fabricated. Why? He said, because Jibra'il and Mika'il are two sinless angels. They've never committed sins. While Abu Bakr and Umar spent most of their lives worshipping idols. And they only accepted Islam towards the end of the when in, during old age.
There's no comparison. Yeah.
There's no comparison between two sinless angels and two, you know,
two humans that sin.
Two humans that sin.
On that note, Sayyidina, it's been a pleasure to have this discussion with you on this very happy occasion. That is the birth of Imam Al-Jawad.
The pleasure is all mine.
I'd like to thank Sayyid Hussein Al-Qazwini for joining us. I'd like to thank you, dear viewers, for watching. And inshallah, you will join us on the next episode where we will be joined again by our dear friend, Sayyid Hussein Al-Qazwini, where we will discuss further on the life of Imam Al-Jawad, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Thank you very much. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.